What's up, Max?
Ooh, this is what it's like being on the other side of the recording.
Uh-huh.
It's weird.
I started the show. I wanted to start the show in my natural tongue, Pittsburghese.
Oh, fuck off. That's what you actually sound like, is it?
Yeah, it's the way we all talk around here.
It doesn't even sound real. You sound so regarded.
This is the way people fucking talk. Our friend Technology Culture would have a field day with this shit.
You sound like Ted, but like a special needs version.
Everybody from Pittsburgh is special needs for sure. I don't want to be inauthentic, you know? I want to show people the real me.
Do you put on a special accent the rest of the time just so people take you seriously?
Yeah, it's totally fake. Everybody in my fucking family talks like this.
Wow.
Yeah, for those that don't know, I'm from Pittsburgh, PA. The Iron City, Steel City, City of Champions. You ever heard of us?
No. Wish I had, though. You sound fucking great.
Everybody from Pittsburgh calls themselves Yinzers. So instead of saying, like, you guys or y'all, we say Yinz.
Please stop it.
No.
Can we go back to the slightly less retarded version of you?
No. No, we can't. Max, I want to go over a few Pittsburgh words with you. Okay?
Go on, then.
I'm going to get you caught up. All right. First word. Warsh. What do you think Warsh is?
Someone who can't spell, he's trying to say Porsche.
No. I had to go down to the laundromat and wash my clothes.
Wash.
Correct.
Wow.
Who was the first president of the United States?
George Washington.
George Washington. See, you got it. Okay. Next one. Gum ban. A gum ban.
Oh, I just don't know.
Okay. The postman has the best gum bands.
I still don't know.
Okay, when the postman comes by, I say, hey, you got any gum bands?
I still don't know.
A rubber band.
Oh, my God.
You call a rubber band a gum band. Next word, Max. Jag.
Can we promise this is the last one? Because I'm losing brain cells.
This is the last one.
Sniffing diesel. Jag.
Yeah.
The car? No, it can't be, because that would be what it
is. We can't afford them fucking cars here.
Jogging. Someone who jogs.
Oh, that's close. No, I can see where you're going with that. Okay, jag is like a root word. So if you got jagged, you get like pricked, like by a thorn or something. But we don't call them thorns either. They're called jaggers. So if a jagger jagged you, you got stuck by a thorn. And then you also, there's thorns that come from a jagger bush. So you can say like, oh, fuck, I've been drinking too much beer. I got to go in the woods and take a piss. And then, fuck, oh, no, I got stuck in a jagger bush.
Please, if you get stuck there, just don't come back.
Don't come back at all. But a jag could be like somebody like, hey, you're fucking being a jagger. And like means you're like taking being a piss.
Okay. Yes.
And if you are participating in this kind of behavior, you're a jag off.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I like that.
All right. Last word, Max.
No, that's it, I reckon.
Last word. Ready?
Okay.
Show.
Is it like sure, but you just can't speak?
Nope. It's like, let's start the show.
Bitcoin is close to becoming worthless.
Now, what's the Bitcoin?
Bitcoin's like rat poison. Yeah. Oh. The greatest scam in history.
Let's get it.
Bitcoin will go to fucking zero.
I won't speak like that ever again.
It's only up from here. Both Bitcoin and the quality of the show.
I'm sorry I did that to you.
That's okay. That's okay. I forgive you. How's the hip? I know A, you're getting old, and B, you fell down some stairs. So you all right?
Well, thanks for letting the world know. I was keeping that a secret. I guess everybody knows. I fell down the stairs like an old man.
Yep.
And I hurt my hip.
Hobbling around.
Yeah, like an idiot.
Missed a step with his walking stick and just tumbled down.
You know what I did? I was carrying stuff downstairs. I slipped. My whole feet fall out from underneath me. I land right on the edge of the step on my hip. I slide down the steps like an idiot. I'm carrying some glass. It shatters everywhere.
Brilliant.
Number one and number three are upstairs.
I'm cursing. I stand up, punch the wall, freaking out. Nobody says anything. Dad, are you okay? Is everything all right down there? Nobody says anything. Just down there by myself with a broken hip. So much my kids love me. And like 5 minutes later, number one comes down. Are you okay? Yeah, I'm okay.
At least,
yeah.
At least you said, are you okay?
Then number three comes down and asking for something.
Well, I liked the other day when we were having a conversation and one of the girls walks in. I don't know which one it was and goes, Daddy, where's my gun? And I thought, that is quality parenting.
Yeah.
Where's my fucking Glock?
We're Americans. That was number two. It wasn't a real gun, Max.
What did you say? Bitches be fronting.
That's what I said to her. Yep.
Quality.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I hope you're all right, mate.
Thank you.
You know, if it all gets too much, we'll put a pool together and send in some stats and see if we can get you in a home.
Yeah, at least a hip replacement. By the way, I went to the doctor today and I'm fine. It was just a contusion.
For anyone who cared.
Yeah, the one person.
Mm-hmm. Maybe.
Yeah, that's overestimating it.
Right, come on. What do we got? What Bitcoin stuff have we got?
Well, we start to show off with some fountain boosts. You know, the show is called Pleb Miner Monthly. And that's something we did with Pleb Miner Month, is the show's not all about us and my hip. It's about the plebs. They're just as much as part of the show as anybody else.
Chet, 21,021 sats. Very generous. Thank you, Chet.
Yeah, he is.
Bitcoin wins. I picture John's palms all sweaty. Is that true, Max? You hand-holding sickos. None of this monkey picture shit matters. On a long enough timeline, Bitcoin reveals all scammers. Great episode. Don't listen to Alex. Buy Avalon's. Lol. Hash sluts is going to be awesome.
Yeah,
but I'd rather be in the mine, bro. Yeah, Medi is awesome. And his chat is deaf family. His chat is deaf family. Don't know what that means.
The Lincoin Telegram group chat.
Ah, okay.
It's like a little family in there.
He took my naked pic down. Lol, 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 lol. I don't fucking blame him.
When all that inscription stuff was coming in, I guess Chet had found a block with a nudie pic in it, a beaver shot. He posted that in the Lincoin Telegram group, and Medi was like, I'm shutting this down. Get this out of here. Not on my blockchain. Next boost is from Bert de Groot. 21,000 sats. LMFAO MFers. Dirty is Jesus. Talking about dirty shot, yeah, I assume. Stay sovereign out there in the physical realm. Sending flowers mined with Bitcoin for you pussies. Your foundation passport, discreet, official reseller, and official node runner FM dancer. Cheap ad by Bitcoin Braybrant. So you can get a foundation device's passport from Bert. He's an official reseller.
Just email foundation and go, listen, I would have bought and used Max's code, but I've gone to Bert de Groot because he did pay 21,000 sats for an advert. So to be fair, I'm going to go there now.
And they might send you two.
They might do. Self-banked, 21,000 sats. Vires in numeris.
Ooh, Latin. He's smart.
Mm-hmm. Bon, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sats. Another great episode, guys. I set the passport up and have managed to receive, wipe, and restore. It's just as nice and fancy to use as it looks. A beauty inside and out.
Just like you.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Crown really is on fire, fire, fire these days. The site and YouTube look great. Till next episode, boost you later. Thanks, Bon.
Yeah, I agree with everything Bon said right there. Mm-hmm. Next one is Weissen der Teufel. 10,000 sats. Keep it up, you glorious bastards. Great listen for a Friday morning, or any morning, for that matter. Next up, Burn Miner. 10,000 sats. John, why you say fucking zero? There's a story behind that.
Sounded very Asian there. Why you say fucking zero?
Well, because here's a story. My daughters come in here all the time and have this little soundboard that we use for the show, and it's still loaded up with all these things. And of course, the bit-by-bit intro is first thing on there. Number three is always in here pressing that button, putting on my headphones, listening to Bitcoin is going to fucking zero. And she's listening to this one day, and you can, you know, when somebody's listening on their headphones, especially a kid, they think they're saying the words, but they're just kind of like mumbling, but she doesn't realize it. She's over here going, Bitcoin for fucking zero. I was like, whoa, hey. She thinks I say the intro. You know, this has been your intro for what, 3-4 years. But, you know, kids, she thinks I say the intro. And she takes the headphones off. She goes, Daddy, why you say fucking zero?
That's brilliant.
So I told old Burn Matter that. Next one, Ape Mithrandir. Boy, that guy supports a lot of shows.
He does.
He's like the value for value king. 7,778 sats. The Pleb Miner was wild. Talking about dirty. He sure as hell was. Business Cat, 7,777.
Before we move on to Business Cat, Ape Mithrandir also does bite-sized boosts for our bite-sized shows as well.
Yes, he does.
Just he's cool. Throw that in there. He is cool.
Can I say another Ape Mithrandir thing? He is on a certain, I won't say where, but wallet, Telegram group, always helping people out in that group. And that's pretty awesome.
Can confirm.
Business Cat, 7,777 sats. The S9 is the Kalashnikov of ASIC world. It's true. Wonder what the M16 is. Self-banked, again, 2,100 sats. Big love from Self-banked.
Big love right
big
back at you, mate.
Love. And, oh, you know what? I don't think I was supposed to read all these yet. Too many. We'll move on.
We'll move on.
We'll save some for later. Mm-hmm. You pour yourself a coffee.
Oh, you hear that, do you?
Yeah, I do. And we'll play some statistics.
Statistics. I'ma tell you the basics for hashing with ASICs. Bitcoin mining statistics. It's simple mathematics. Check it out. I'll revolve around science. What are we talking about here? Statistics. Statistics. I'ma tell you the basics for hashing with ASICs. Bitcoin mining statistics. It's simple mathematics. Check it out. Statistics.
Statistics brought to you by Lincoin Mining. Did you see what I said there, Max? Lincoin Mining. I didn't say Lincoin Pool.
Expand.
Lincoin has changed their Twitter handle to Lincoin Mining.
Oh.
Because they are so much more than a mining pool.
I did see that tweet.
They have Lincoin Lens. That is a web-based tool that you can use to figure out all these different statistics within the Bitcoin mining world. And that's what we use here on Pleb Miner Monthly to figure out our statistics, like global hash rate. Global hash rate is 334 exahash. Lincoln Pool's hash rate is 641 petahash. They're number 16 in the world, but number one in our hearts at Pleb Miner Monthly. Over the past month, the highest one-day moving average, and these one-day moving averages are insane, as we know, hard to get real data from them, but one day, on February 28th, it was as high as 365 exahash. Smooth out the graph a little bit and look at the seven-day moving average. The highest was 334 exahash, and our 30-day is now above 300. It's 316. 60-day moving average is also above 300 at 304, and some change.
I can't stop thinking that I'm going to be right.
Did you say 380?
Mm-hmm.
Hmm. How do you do it? If only you could predict other things in your life like that.
Well, I can. I also predicted Whirlpool's going to be 10,000 or above by end of year. And they're both quite bold statements, but I think I'm going to be right on both of them.
What do you win if you get these right?
Hearts and minds. Respect.
My eternal adoration.
And then I'm going to do a trading course for $800.
Mm-hmm. You should.
A person.
Max Brunel. Difficulty. Hold on. I get a cough.
That is an old man cough.
Thank you. Difficulty. Difficulty threshold is 43.55 trillion. We are to adjust in like 2 days, I think, and are expecting an increase in difficulty of, I don't know, a lot. I'm not going to say. I don't like those predictions. If it's like two, three blocks before the next difficulty adjustment, I'll throw it out there. But I think our block time right now is like 9 minutes and 30 seconds. So that's going to be an upward difficulty adjustment. With this level of difficulty and price of Bitcoin, we are at the 9.7 cents a kilowatt hour break-even mark for a 29 joules per terahash, 100 terahash machine. Let's take a look at the Antminer S19 XP, 140 terahash. Its break-even price is 15 cents. So, geez, that's 5 cents more you could pay and still break even on that machine. On difficulty, I have a quote from Chet, and I like the way Chet puts things sometimes. He says, from our Pleb Miner Month founding father, Chet, last year's difficulty went up 30%. It's up over 20% with recent difficulty adjustments this year. He says, fucking hurts, but that is the only metric that matters. Difficulty. There are a few other metrics that matter. Man, that one can hit you hard.
Wise words from Uncle Chet.
Thank you, Uncle Chet. Transaction fees as a percentage of block reward. Transaction fees as a percentage of block reward has gone up a bit over the past month. Some days as high as 4.13%, 4.72%, and the highest day this month was March 8th. And your transaction fees as a percentage of block reward on that day was 5%. So on last show, I had looked at a few recent blocks and we were about 2 to 3% for the transaction fees. Now on a few days, we're up to 5%. So miners are getting a little bump in their take-home pay.
Nice.
Every little bit helps. Hash price.
What the fuck was that?
It was a motorcycle.
I thought that sounded like my dog. I was like, oh, no, you don't have a Frenchie.
Don't have a Frenchie. No. All right. I'll let that douchebag and his crotch rocket has gone by my house. Hash price. Bitcoin is in the 27-28 region, making hash price around $8 a day per 100 terahash. That's up a little bit from the last show. Again, that little bump in price helps. Difficulty going up, that really screws you when price isn't going up. But man, just seeing the rewards come in when we are at 28 feels great, being at the numbers that we have been in for a long time. But of course, here's the most important number. You're going to get about 28,000 sats a day. And we were at about 34,000 sats a day per 100 terahash. So you're getting fewer sats again in this particular epoch, but they are worth more. Machine profitability. This is the expected amount of sats per day and a couple machine prices. We have the Kaboom Racks S9, which of course are selling for $125. Those will get you 4,220 sats a day. That's about $1.17 worth of Bitcoin, but it costs you $3.25 a day to run. An M50, what's miner M50? 28, 29 joules per terahash. That's not to be confused with the more efficient M50S. They put an S on the end of it, and all of a sudden that gets you 26 joules per terahash. It's amazing how they do that. Alex has a variety of M50s available, and they are a pretty good price, the low $19 a terahash, and they have a break even of 11.6 cents. So reach out to Alex if you're interested in a What's Miner M50. I like looking at this kind of stuff at this point because the machine prices haven't really caught up with the bump in Bitcoin prices. So now's not a bad time to let go of some Bitcoin to get a couple new machines if you're interested.
Was it the M50s that Selfbanked was looking at the other day?
Nah, I think he was looking at a M31 S++. Some of these are a good deal. He also has a bunch of S19 J Pros, and I think they're $1,700-something. And that's going to get you 28,888 sats a day with a break even of 11 cents a kilowatt hour.
That's what you really want to push him into because you're a massive Bitmain shill.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah. They pay me. I haven't gotten anything from him yet. I was really tempted by these M50s. That's why I wrote this down, because I was looking through Alex's inventory and it's like, ooh, well, that's not bad. I could have one of those.
I'd be buying here if I could run them.
Why? What about these numbers really, I don't know, motivates you to want to buy now?
It's more of like a gut feeling of the trade-off of like selling some sats at this point probably isn't the worst timing for these machines. It's not like I've sat and crunched the numbers. It's more of a feeling.
Yeah.
And as you know, I'm always right.
Yeah. Everybody knows that. Yeah, I kind of get that feeling too. And Barn Miner and a couple of his buddies just bought some new machines. And I think he got an M50 and he posted a video the other day. Man, I love the way that What's Miner spin up. They sound better because they have a bigger fan. They just have like one big fan on the back as opposed to two in the back and the front. Mm-hmm. They have one on the back and the front, but it's big. Mm-hmm. And just the way it spins up. I don't know. I am liking What's Miners more and more. Like, yes, they're not as efficient and they cost a little bit more joules per terahash sometimes, but I don't know. There's just something cool about them.
Bitmain haven't paid him, guys. So he's going to be changing.
Yeah. Jumping ship. Statistic has been brought to you by Lincoin Mining. And like I said before, Lincoin Pool has changed their Twitter handle to Lincoin Mining. And why is that? Because they are not just a mining pool. They're a mining experience with revenue management, firmware, market analysis, and of course, a mining pool. So that's what they originally did. They also have their Lincoin Agent Miner management software and their Teams function. Teams allows you to provision different levels of authorization on your account. So you can have different roles. I could even provision you on my account, Max, if I wanted to. Like, you know, you have your manager, technicians, host, your accountant, and then I could have like my retarded buddy. You could log in there and adjust something if you want.
Fuck something up.
Yeah. And of course, you can also put on your team Boty MacBotFace.
Hello, Boty.
What's up? My home is...
What's up, Boty?
Max, I get the feeling you don't think my jokes are very funny.
Oh.
Can confirm.
Oof. Hey, don't listen to him, Boty. He's a big downer.
Okay, well, I'll tell my joke now. What does garlic do when it gets hot?
What does garlic do when it gets hot? You got any guesses, Max?
No, I still don't care.
I knew it. The miserable son of a bitch.
It takes its clothes off. Clothes off.
Thank you, Boty. That was an excellent joke. We appreciate you being here in studio. Hey, man, you want to hear a bite-sized Bitcoin?
Yeah, why not?
To begin with, what is Bitcoin?
1 bit 47.
A lot of people are familiar with Lightning and Liquid. Is
I sound smart there, don't I?
Yeah, you do. What is bit 47?
Shor and Taproot, that's the first new protocol upgrade since SegWit.
Difficulty adjustments.
How do mnemonic seed words work?
UTXO. Management.
A little Q&A there.
I got him to record that specially for me.
He's awesome.
He's a fucking knob.
Bite-sized Bitcoin. This... You're going to keep that in. Bitcoin Q&A is a knob? No, he's not. You would never say that to his sweet, beautiful face.
No, I would not.
Today's Bite-sized Bitcoin is on... The continuation from our block creation, bite-sized Bitcoin, and now it is mining transactions. But before we get to that, we want to talk about our sponsor, FixRigs. Hash rate is going up. Hash value is going up. Hal Finning is coming up in a year. You want to have your machines ready to go. You love the Hal Finning. Ready to go.
I fucking love it
for when
so
the price
much.
Pumps and you've transitioned from low power mode to ludicrous speed. Be sure to keep your machines in tip-top, ready to deploy a shape by sending them to FixRigs. FixRigs is a premium repair facility located in Miami, Florida. They are staffed with highly trained technicians who are ready to diagnose, repair, and clean your machine and get it sent back to you ASAP so you can get back to hashing. FixRigs not only has highly qualified technicians, a state-of-the-art facility, but they are masters of logistics. They have you covered in all aspects of the repair process. There you go, Max. Got broken machines? Huh? Do you? Maximilian von Bittenstein, answer me.
No, I don't have broken machines. But if I did, I would send them there. Although, they won't fucking come on my show, so...
It's just scheduling.
I'm a bit upset about it. I really want to dig in, learn about the business, talk some shit with them. But they're like, yeah, we've got 100 things on our list and... You're right at the bottom.
You're really low.
You fucking pleb.
Well, maybe after they listen to this bite-sized Bitcoin, they may change their mind.
Please come on the show.
To begin with, what is Bitcoin?
1 bit 47.
A lot of people are familiar with Lightning, and Liquid is effectively layer 2.
Bit 129.
What is Taproot?
Shor and Taproot, that's the first new protocol upgrade since SegWit.
Difficulty adjustments.
How do mnemonic seed words work?
UTXO management.
Early Bitcoin adopter Mike Hearn writes to Satoshi on April 12th, 2009. Hi, Satoshi. I read your paper on Bitcoin with great interest. I found it a bit confusing, though. I believe it may be easier to follow if you provide some examples. Specifically, it's not quite clear to me what blocks contain. He then goes on to ask if only one chain is recording all of the transactions, or the story of the economy, as Mr. Hearn states. Satoshi responds 10 hours later. Hi, Mike. I'm glad to answer any questions you have. If I get time, I ought to write an FAQ to supplement the paper. He follows with, there is only one global chain. The two continue their back and forth for 2 weeks, chatting about the protocol and even talking about sending transactions back and forth. Unfortunately for Mike Hearn, Satoshi doesn't directly answer the initial question, what do blocks contain? But fortunately for you, at Ungovernable Misfits, we have the Bite-sized Bitcoin series. In this episode of Bite-sized Bitcoin, we will use our previous Bite-sizes hash to extend our chain of understanding of Bitcoin block creation, and cover how transactions make their way into a block to be recorded on the one global chain forever. Have you committed the components of the block header to memory? In case you haven't, they are version number, the previous block's hash,
the Merkle root of proposed transactions, timestamp, target for proof of work, and a nonce. These are the components of the block header. The bulk of the block is transaction data. When a mining node is attempting to solve for the next block, they are doing so by using a candidate block filled with proposed transactions, as transactions are the building blocks of the network, the transfer of value from one address to another. A transaction makes it into the memory pool or mempool by first being broadcast to a node after it passes its validation checks, ensuring that the transaction is properly formatted, that the inputs are valid, have sufficient funds, and that the transaction signature is valid. The transaction data within a Bitcoin block contains information about each transaction included in the block. Some of the key characteristics and definitions of the transaction data include input and output addresses. Every transaction in the Bitcoin network involves transfer of Bitcoin from one or more input addresses to one or more output addresses. Amount of Bitcoin. Each transaction includes information about the amount of Bitcoin being transferred. This is information represented as a decimal number and is specified in Bitcoin, not Satoshis. The transaction fee, that's self-explanatory, and signature data. In order for a transaction to be valid, it must be signed by the owner of the input address using a digital signature. The signature data provides proof that the owner of the input address authorized the transaction and is included in the transaction data. You also have scripts. Scripts can be used to specify the conditions under which the Bitcoin being transferred can be spent. Now the transactions have to get into the block. Miners use the block template to create a candidate block, as we know. Once again, it's a blueprint that provides the necessary information for a miner to create a candidate block. In other words, a candidate block is a block that has been partially created and is waiting to be solved by a miner. The candidate block contains all the necessary information to become the next block. Just gotta get that nonce right, that's the rub. When a miner requests a block template from the network, the template includes a list of transactions that the miner can then choose from. The miner selects the transactions that they want to include in the block based on a criteria that they choose, such as transaction fees, the priority of the transaction. Miners can also prioritize transactions with a smaller size, as this allows them to include more transactions in each block, thus earning them more fees overall. Transaction priority is another factor that miners consider when selecting transactions. Priority is calculated based on the age, size, and value of the inputs used in a transaction, with older inputs and larger values being given higher priority. This is because these inputs have a higher opportunity cost for the sender, and thus they are more likely to be willing to pay a higher fee to have the transaction processed quickly. In general, miners have their own priorities and preferences. I repeat, the miners have their own priorities and preferences. Miners' incentives are normally whatever allows them the most Bitcoin. But sometimes, they don't prioritize the highest transaction fees, because miners don't have to pull from the mempool to decide what transactions to mine. They can decide on transactions based on other criteria. Not choosing transactions from the mempool is considered out of band. A mining pool can accomplish this by supplying the transaction data directly to a miner. The pool puts that transaction data into their candidate block. They generate the Merkle root of the transactions and send that candidate block header to its miners to hash. That's why in the last episode of Bitesize Bitcoin, we asked the question, do you know what your pool's candidate blocks look like? Are they being upfront with their miners about how they construct their candidate blocks? When all the transactions a miner has chosen are placed into the block is characterized by having a certain weight. In a Bitcoin block, weight refers to a metric used to determine the size of a block in terms of its impact on the network's overall capacity. The weight of a block is calculated as a multiple of a unit called a weight unit, WU. Well, that makes sense, doesn't it? Before the introduction of SegWit, the size of a block was simply the sum of its serialized bytes, and the maximum block size was limited to 1 megabyte. With the activation of SegWit, however, the weight field was introduced as a new way of measuring block size that takes into account the structure of the block data. The weight of a block is calculated as the sum of the weight of its transactions, where each transaction is assigned a weight based on its size and structure. The weight field is used in the Bitcoin network to enforce the block size limit and to ensure that the network remains secure and efficient. By using the weight field to measure block size, the network is able to effectively increase its capacity while also ensuring that blocks remain small enough to be easily propagated and validated by nodes on the network. I know, heavy stuff. Maybe that's why Satoshi didn't just outright answer Mike Hearn when he asked him, what do blocks contain? But here at Ungovernable Misfits, we don't mind answering Bitcoin questions in the form of a bite-sized Bitcoin or FUDbuster. If you have a question about Bitcoin, or a friend or family member has a question about Bitcoin and you just can't quite answer it or are too aggravated with them to answer it, let us know and we will try to cover it. Additionally, if you would like to record a bite-sized Bitcoin or FUDbuster, let us know too. We'd be happy to pass off some of our workload to you. It doesn't pay, but we'd be eternally grateful. That was a rousing bite-sized Bitcoin, wasn't it, Max?
It was. Even after editing it and listening to it a million times, I still enjoy it. Many people writing to me about it as well, they say, although it's really dull the first, second, and third time, it starts to seep in and you start to learn after you've listened to it a few times. And people are finding it valuable. So, yeah, appreciate your time, mate.
I'm glad. I check the fountain boosts for every episode on BitBitBit that I'm involved in, and Fistful of Sats commented on the other one and kind of said the same thing. So I appreciate that somebody is listening and that they provide some value. I also said in the Bitesize Bitcoin that if you would like to record a Bitesize Bitcoin, let us know.
Any takers?
Huh? Anyone? Anyone? Hands up.
Lazy fucks.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people will say, oh yeah, I'll do one. And then... do they fucking do it?
Or you could write one. You don't have to record it. We understand the recording takes a long time. Just write us one.
Yeah, that's true. Some FUDbusters would be nice as well.
Yeah. Next one, we'll do FUDbuster.
So someone has to send something in, a FUDbuster. It can be about anything Bitcoin related, and you've got to bust some type of FUD. As long as it's under 10 minutes, we're all good. Either record it and I'll edit it and put it out, or you can just send it in and we'll read it out.
Can confirm.
And what do they get? Just stickers?
Yeah, that's all I got.
Just stickers?
Just stickers. That's all the fucking swag I have. I have these coasters. Maybe I'll send you stickers and a coaster.
If it's good enough, you'll get a coaster as well. One coaster.
Yeah, but if whatever shows up in the mail. Like if you just get stickers, you're like, oh, I guess that sucked.
Well, at least they know where they stand.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
How about some fountain boosts?
Yes, that's what I was just about to say. Mr. G, 2023 sats. Here are 10 reasons to become a pleb miner. 1, you become better in tune with the network.
Mm-hmm.
2, you become better working with exotic tools, soldering irons.
Sure.
That's an example.
It's exotic.
3, you see the need to defend the Bitcoin network. 4, you end up stacking hash rate plus Satoshis. 5, your IT senses get sharper. 6, you begin to seek cheaper power resources.
Mm-hmm.
7, the Hal Finning is near, so fucking build. 8, no more erectile dysfunction.
Can confirm.
9, you get to laugh at large bloated operations when they fail. Dirty Shotcher is a crazy son of a gun.
Also can confirm.
No, he said 10. Where's 10?
He didn't number the 10. You figure it out. It's the Dirty Shot you won. That's number 10. Okay. Don't question Mr. G. He put a lot of time and effort into that.
He did.
And 2023 sats.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Mr. G.
Next one is from Norman Remnant. 1069 sats. Dirty Shot you can go fuck himself. Stay alive, brother.
So sweet.
It is. Next one's from Rafa. Keep dropping that gangster shit, brothers. Stay up, stay healthy. Then he signs his name Rafa, like I didn't know it was you. Mr. G put 256 sats.
Nice.
He says, ha ha, I was boost number 21 this episode. Sunglasses, electricity.
You're misrepresenting his speech there.
Yeah.
The sunglasses, hey. Smiley with a lightning bolt.
Okay, I'm sorry. I had noticed as you were reading the Mr. G one that you had figured out a lot of these emojis. Like you translated them out loud.
Yeah. I know about emojis.
Yeah, well, that's like the generational difference between you and I. You're hip to this young guy stuff.
It's dyslexia, mate.
Oh.
Like words are a problem, but images make sense.
That's what makes you such a great artist.
And handsome.
Yes. I don't know how that factors in here, but sure.
Me neither.
Next one's from Blizza, 200 sats, and he says...
Good point.
Mm-hmm. Number 3 is in the other room and she yells.
Yeah, I heard that. What did she say?
I don't know, but
I love how she responds to it.
Sounded like she said stack.
She may have.
Stack!
Solid advice, number three. Fast boost is from FW7, 103 sats, and he gives a plus one sat every show. He started out at 100.
Mm-hmm.
I would expect on the next episode when this releases that he will boost 104 sats. Just saying.
I think you might be right. Also, I think it's my favorite NIM, FW7.
Yeah, you always have a reaction to that.
I just find it really funny. I don't know why.
Well, he must be a cool, funny guy. Or gal. Yeah,
it tickles me every single time.
Easily entertained.
That's why I do the show with you, mate.
Jiminy Christmas. Pleb Miner Monthly Action News.
It's Pleb Miner Monthly Action News, your trusted source for news on the Bitcoin mining scene. We go via our mining stats to give you the skinny, the lowdown, the scoop, the info you need to know. Nico Smith with news and market insight. Bitcoin Bassload with energy market updates. Pleb in the Field, Burn Miner. And your anchors, Max, Bit by Bit, and John D.
Pleb Miner Monthly Action News is brought to you by Kaboom Rex. Kaboom Rex Alex. That's right. Kaboom Rex Alex sponsors this show. Do you need gear, Max? Do you want to buy more machines?
No, but if I did, I know where I'd go.
Mm-hmm. Where would you go?
Anywhere else. No, not really. I'd go to Alex.
Mm-hmm.
We love Alex.
You know, Kaboom Rex has parts as well. So say that you don't want to send the whole machine over to FixRigs. You're pretty technical. You can replace a control board, a fan, something like that. Say, yo, Alex, give me them parts.
And what would he say?
He'd say, sure. Like that.
Sure. What's your code? Because you got to give the code.
Ah, yeah. Well, the code's only for free cables.
Okay.
Our code is Pleb Miner universally. You want to go to Peach? This isn't Peach's spot, but why not talk about them? We can do whatever the fuck we want to. It's our show.
Good point.
You want to sign up for Peach? You're in the right locale. Check into it. Not every locale is available. You sign up for Peach, you put in the Pleb Miner shill code. That makes you cool.
Pleb Miner.
One word. Anyway. Pleb Miner Monthly Action News is sponsored by Kaboom Rex. They got gear, they got parts, they have potential hosting. Should you need it, reach out to Kaboom Rex Alex. That's at Kaboom Rex Alex on Twitter. I think it's his on Telegram.
I think so too.
You could even send him a nudie pic if you want, if you're into that.
It might give you a better discount.
Better discount than Pleb Miner.
You got to actually write Pleb Miner on whatever body part you're sending though. Then you will get cables and maybe something extra.
Oh yeah. Our first story on Pleb Miner Monthly Action News is from Nico Smid. You can go to Nico Smid's Substack. That's Nico Smid, nicosmid.substack.com. If you want to read all of his really cool articles. This one's on navigating the ASIC market cycles, and we talked about that earlier in the show, and you have a gut feeling.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Nico has an article. I don't know. Up to you what you think is more important, your gut feeling or Nico's well-researched article. Nico says, fluctuations in the Bitcoin ASIC miner market are common.
Fluctuations.
Did I say fluctuations?
Yeah. Nico says, fluctuations in the...
hanging around you too much. I'm going to say it again.
Don't say it again.
Fluctuations in the Bitcoin ASIC miner market are common due to the dynamic nature of the Bitcoin mining industry. The demand for ASIC miners can vary based on several factors, including the price of Bitcoin, we've run into that, the difficulty of mining, and the availability of mining hardware. In order to run a successful mining business, it is important to time the ASIC market optimally. Buying mining machines at the bottom of a bear market as opposed to buying at the top of a bull market can make a huge difference. Well, no shit, Nico. But he goes into more deeper analysis in the amount of hash rate you can obtain for your money and the time it takes to get a return on your investment. In this article, I delve into the cyclicality of the ASIC market and explore the following topics: drivers of price, ASIC market cycles, how to optimize market entry, build infrastructure in the bull market, sell mined BTC in the bull market, temporarily co-locate miners, should you need to, use hosting as a placeholder,
which when we talk to our Pleb Miner in the wild, he has a story about hosting and moving from hosting to doing your own stuff. But that's a good point from Nico's perspective, that sometimes, hey, I don't know what to do with these machines. I'm now getting rug pulled on where I have them. I'm just going to host them for a little bit until I figure things out. At least you're not sending them to a warehouse somewhere where they're just sitting. There's a lot of hosting providers out there. Find a place to put them and then figure out your game plan. And lastly, he says, move less efficient ASIC to cheaper locations, if that's available. Like I said before, the entire article is on Nico Smith's Substack, where he goes into greater detail on these particular strategies for figuring out what to do when Bitcoin price goes up, but ASIC prices are kind of smoothing out, or maybe you've been hodling for a while and you need to get some liquidity. Good advice here from Nico.
Talk about our new show.
Yeah.
We have a new show.
We do.
It's not out yet. It's not fully edited yet. It's been sent over to Mr. Crown, though. And fuck me, it's good.
Mm-hmm. I'm not going to fuck you, but it is good.
That was to the audience, not you.
Oh.
It is short, sharp, and what else is it? Just brilliant.
Newsworthy. Well, we're not going to give too much away.
No, I don't think we should.
People will hear the show.
They will. Well, they might. It still needs to get out.
I'll tell them this. If you love Pleb Miner Monthly Action News, you're really going to love Pleb Miner Monthly Action News Update.
I think they might guess what it's about now.
They might. Ooh, I gave away too much. Sorry.
What else we got? Barn Miner visit?
Yeah, Barn Miner came over to visit.
How was that?
Showed him around.
Bet you did.
Showed him the chickens. Showed him my shooting range out back. He got to see my tractor and my mining setup. And then we drank whiskey and talked about how much we really like you.
Yeah, I'll bet you did. That actually sounds like a fun visit.
It was a fun visit. It was short. I wish you could have stayed longer.
Tractors, miners, whiskey. That's proper like man cave stuff.
Yeah.
I really like that.
Now you understand why my daughter's coming in asking where her gun is at. You get it now.
Yeah, I do. And then Bar Miner's sending me pictures of alligators that he's frying up for nuggets.
Yeah, what a cool life he has.
Here's an alligator I shot earlier. Oh, okay. Wow. Okay then, mate. Like, what do you do with that? Make gator nuggets.
Florida man shoots alligator.
Actually, it's probably quite nice. And the like cheap bastard that I am, I was thinking, fuck, I wish we had them here, because then I wouldn't have to go on a food shop.
To shoot alligators.
Yeah, why not? I would do that. Apparently it tastes like chicken.
When I lived in Florida, that was a thing. Like, you could get a bounty for alligators because they were kind of taking over the Everglades. I don't know if that's still the case. Yeah, yeah. Like, the game commission would give you money for shooting an alligator.
Well, I was actually just thinking just free meat.
Oh, those game wardens will come and get you, man. I tell you, there's nobody has more power in the United States than a local game commission. They can come on your property warrantless. They can come in your house warrantless.
What?
Yeah, man. Yep. Yeah, look it up. They have like extra powers, game wardens.
I thought you guys were all tough and you're like, come and take it. Come into my house, see what happens.
Yeah.
What happens to all that? Game warden, you go, oh, that's all out the window then.
It's all just about come in.
I didn't know that.
We've got a new feature on Pleb Miner Monthly Action News. Our Bassload update is actually by Bassload.
Sup, y'all? There's three buckets to focus on.
It's physical, financial, and regulatory energy risk. That's important.
Peace and love, y'all. That's important. What's up, y'all? If you're asking yourself, how do I manage energy market risk regarding price? There's three buckets to focus on: financial, physical, and regulatory energy market risk. Financially, just how everything is priced. Physically, what risks do I have with the infrastructure associated with consuming electricity, natural gas, propane, fuel oil? What's up, y'all? The regulatory side is what federal, state, public utility commission type of influence are they going to have on price, because they absolutely do. Focusing on those three, even though I briefly described them all, is quite complex and absolutely necessary to manage energy market risk regarding price. That's important. It's physical, financial, and regulatory energy risk. Love y'all. Peace.
I love that. I'm going to play that when I go to sleep. It's relaxing just hearing his voice. You learn while you listen. I love it.
I love it too. And thank you, Bassload, for recording that.
Who edited that then?
I edited that, sir.
Good work.
Thank you very much. The first compliment you've ever paid me.
You see, you're not too old.
You can't teach an old dog new tricks.
That was very good. I like that.
So let's talk about those three buckets for a second, Max. Mm-hmm. The physical, financial, and regulatory risk when you're pricing energy. The reason Baseload tries to communicate that so plainly and succinctly is because I think he gets really frustrated to see all these people go into mining, think they're getting a price, but they didn't take all of these things into account before they started building out their mining operations. And he's always saying like to us, like, man, they just reach out to me. Just let me know. I'll teach them all about it. He's very passionate about that.
Well, you see a lot of people getting tripped up all the time. Mm-hmm. So it's good to have someone watching out and giving this sort of advice.
Yeah, like to understand the financial part of it, I think that's something that people can grasp, but mm-hmm. it's so much more complicated than say, oh, yep, I have 7.5 cents a kilowatt hour. Then you might have the regulatory side come into things. Jeff Hotz will talk about that in our Pleb Miner in the Wild. But simple things like the local commission might not want you building there for X reason, or they might want to, like Jeff Hotz talks about, make sure that you're not building a pig farm right there. Those are things mm-hmm. that you have to understand when you're pricing electricity, is there might be some regulatory action going on. You might live in a locality where they decide you have to have a certain percentage of so-called renewable energy. The regulatory side, the local public utility commission might have certain boxes that they want you to check. It's very complicated. And when you're getting into these kind of things, it's good to have an expert on your side like Baseload.
Baseload and his buckets. He knows his buckets.
Guy knows his buckets. If anything can be said about Bitcoin Baseload, it's his buckets.
He has bucket loads of knowledge.
Oh, I see what you did there. You're so savvy.
Yeah.
Your favorite reporter, Richard Greaser, has written mm-hmm. another article for the Bitcoin Bugle. This one is titled, CIA Director Insists Jason Lowry's Engagement is Organic. Critics of Jason Lowry have cited that the space spook has seemingly come out of nowhere only to dominate the conversation on Bitcoin Twitter. CIA Director William J. Burns defended Jason in his press release by saying, all of Jason's engagement on social media is organic. He's just a bright boy. According to experts on the topic, the CIA has never, ever been known to influence social media personalities' engagement, or to even meddle with social media in general. The U.S. government is committed to peace, prosperity, and somewhat fair speech. Alex Gladstein gave his thoughts on the subject on a Bitcoin magazine Twitter space. You should like Jason Lowry and support him with all your energy, because he is the poster boy for democracy. Jason is like Bitcoin's version of Captain America. He is representing the power that will defeat dictator Vladimir Putin. Across Twitter, there's a great debate over the CIA director's claims. Many Bitcoin maximalist conspiracy theorists, such as cowardly Nim Stony Bitson, are not impressed. I'm going to buy Jason's new book and burn it, tweeted Bitson, which resulted in his account getting banned for the infinite time. That's the truth. Old Stony. According to insiders familiar with the CIA, there is no current effort to disrupt the Bitcoin community, and the CIA is far more concerned with convincing the American people to bankrupt themselves in order to prolong the war in Ukraine. There you have it. Thank you, Richard Greaser.
Well, I believe him.
I do too. I mean, Richard Greaser is reputable. Everybody knows that.
I believe the CIA director.
Do you?
Mm-hmm. I think Jason is a bright boy. He means well.
Good point. I think he does mean well. He's a sweetheart.
Yeah. Fuck you, Stony. Don't be burning his books.
We got our Pleb Miner in the Wild.
These creatures survive by scouring the earth for energy and scavenging hash rate from others whose overexuberance cost them dearly. The Pleb Miner may not be at the top of the food chain, but make no mistake, its ingenuity, scrappy nature, and unquenchable thirst for sats make it a force to be reckoned with.
Pleb Miner in the Wild is sponsored by Peach Bitcoin. Peach Bitcoin recently launched its open beta on March 6th, and you have heard all the hype about Peach Bitcoin, and now you have the opportunity to use it should you be in the right locale. Peach Bitcoin makes it very easy to set up a sell order or a buy order and exchange sats for fiat. or exchange fiat for sats, depending on your orientation. It's very easy. You put up a bid. You want to sell 100,000 sats for 2% over market price. You post that up. You fund the escrow. Once it hits the blockchain and the escrow is funded, it will match you with other people who have something similar on the other side. Once you two are matched, the buyer will pay the seller. No, the seller will pay the buyer.
This is new.
The buyer will pay the seller. Once the buyer pays the seller will verify that they have said funds and release the escrow. And bing, bang, boom, you are done.
And I did see they had, or I'm pretty sure I saw, that they've got a option for cash now. Is that right?
Yeah, they have an option for cash. It's kind of like a meetup thing. And they also have the option for gift cards.
Yes. See, I really like that. That's one thing with Peach or with Bisc or whatever it is you're using. I like, if possible, to take that final bit of risk out, just that final bit where you're doing a bank transfer with someone that you maybe don't know. And it's a really, really nice option and an important option to have these gift cards and to have the cash. So I'm very excited to see them do that.
Max, have you had the opportunity to use our shill code? Have you offered our shill code to any friends or family that wanted to use the Peach product?
I don't know what it is. What is the shill code?
Well, I'm glad you asked, Max. The shill code for Peach is Pleb Miner, one word.
Yes. Yes, I do remember. Yes, I have used it. I just forgot what it was.
Well, I'm here to remind you.
Yeah, so for anyone listening who hasn't yet used Peach and wants to try it out, make sure to use, what was it again? Just remind me.
Our shill code is Pleb Miner.
Yeah, use that.
Our Pleb Miner in the wild is Jeff Hotz. This episode's Pleb Miner in the wild is Jeff Hotz. Jeff spends much of his time in the wild, from hunting game with his trusty German wire-haired pointer named Dot, to hunting for sats at his megawatt-powered farm. Jeff is an ungovernable pleb who cannot be stopped in his quest to mine free. If you want something done right, you got to do it yourself. Welcome to Pleb Miner in the Wild, Jeff.
Thanks. Glad to be here. That's kind of harsh, though. If you want something done right, you got to do it yourself. That, man, that's tough style of leadership.
That definitely seems to be your style. Jeff, I want to talk about your first experiences in Bitcoin mining. How did you get started? What was your setup like at that time?
You know, I tried multiple times from 2012, 2013 to get it running on a CPU and then a GPU, and I was just patently unsuccessful. And I didn't have the time. I was building and running two businesses. So when I was finally successful, I guess it was about 2018, and I bought three dragons and then liked what they did. I think a dragon back then was pulling like well over 100,000 sat a day at like 14 or 15 terahash. Anyway, I like the sound. I like the sats, and started adding more miner. And I'm fortunate. I live out in the country, and I have a good rate. And I happened to have a little cottage that where nobody was living that had a 100-amp panel. So I started plugging in miners until I couldn't plug in any more miners, and let that sit for a while. But knew I wanted more. And I was at a point in businesses where things were going well and didn't need all of my attention. And so I decided to build a fleet. And the best way for me to build a fleet was to buy 10s, 20s, 25 at a time as I had the cash and keep them hosted until I had them all built up in hosting. And then I would build a 1 megawatt mine somewhere and put them in it. And that plan didn't work quite like that.
Tell us about your experience in hosting that many machines. What was the relationship like with the hosting company?
You know, my hosting company has been Blockware, and Mason has been excellent. I appreciate Mason, and I appreciate the access to Mason. And he started with me early. I had 100 machines in their Calvert City, Kentucky plant, which was going well. And I had a sweet deal with Mason that I had direct access to the miners. And everything was going good, and their techs were great because miners break, and they'd get them fixed and bill me for them and put it back together. Yep. But something happened over there. Mason had a long-term lease or something, and the property owner sold it out from under him and then declared force majeure. And my machine sat there for 9 months.
Wow.
And when I plugged them back in, those were not my credentials on those damn miners. Those were not my credentials. No fault to Mason, but I don't know the guys that came in and did that dirty underneath him, but that was shit.
Wow.
Anyway, I just had 100 miners and still had the taste for it. So I accumulated another 100 with Mason. But Mason had learned some stuff and I guess grown quite a bit and changed his operations where not only did I not have access to the miners, I had to mine on his pool. And so that was kind of the first couple of big gongs that this is not going to extend me to the 300 that I want, and I need to start building the facility quicker. And so I kind of realized that in, I guess, 20? Yeah, the fall of 20. Yeah, because that's when that Calvert City, Kentucky thing went under. So I fretted through that. And then in 21, just said, I'm going to pull the trigger and bought transformers and containers and a piece of ground. And boom, there you have it. I have a mine. year and a half. No, that was 22 when I started. Sorry.
So, Jeff, how do you go about that? You have all these hosted machines and you need to pull them out and you say, okay, I'm going to build a farm. What's kind of the first couple steps that you take to get that rolling? Site selection, power company negotiations, equipment selection. How do you go about that?
I had a different strategy, so I knew I'd never be great big. So, and my philosophy or vision on Bitcoin mining is the longer you can last, the more you win. And so it's a long-term sustainable game for me. And so that means chasing cheaper power. And so I happened to hear a rumor of a rumor that there was cheap power in Iowa, and I have a buddy that's in this project with me. His mom and dad have a farm. And so we headed in that direction and got all the way up to talking to the engineers when they said, no, those sales folks don't quite have that rate right. It's 7.75. And we're like, ooh, that's not going to work. So here's kind of a funny story. I've tried all kinds of business development procedures in my 20 some odd years of doing this thing, but I sent a spam. I went to the Association of Iowa Rural Electrical Co-ops, and where they listed all their members. And I looked up all those email addresses and I sent a spam to 35 CEOs of all the small RECs in Iowa. And it said Bitcoin in the title. And of that, four of them did not press delete.
That's a good number.
Yeah, right. Yeah. 10%. We had conversations with four different RECs. We selected this one because they had a transformer for us. It turned out to be not optimal, but that's another lesson learned. Anyway, he had what we were looking for was a megawatt to megawatt and a half of spare capacity on a substation with a real preferential rate. And so we selected the one that had that best. And we had three different options in this REC. We picked the one that was closest, and then the guy wouldn't lease an acre to me, but he would sell it to me. And so I bought an acre here in Iowa. It just happens to be right next to a 1 acre REC solar farm, but it's just adjacent.
Yeah. When you look at the pictures of it, it looks like you're like connected right into that solar farm that's next to your container. That's the perception when you see that. You're like, oh, obviously he's mining off solar.
I'm literally under a windmill too. It's a big energy spot right here. And it's easy to get mistaken because these windmills are all big public co windmills.
Not part of the co-op.
No, the RECs only feed the real rural stuff. Like the substation that I'm on, I share with an egg factory. My miners competing with chickens.
You're all hatching something.
Mm-hmm.
Your first order of business was to reach out to some of these rural co-ops, talk to the CEOs, shaking babies and kissing hands kind of operation. And that's what you have to do. Explain to people face to face because they don't really understand Bitcoin mining and the Bitcoin mining industry and what you can provide to their grid. So what were those initial conversations like once you did get somebody who didn't hit the delete button?
Well, they had been, they had all been approached by other people before, and they were curious because mine had a different tone. And the tone that mine had was, we're looking for a spare kilowatt. We're not looking for 5 megawatts. We're not looking to bring you a problem. We're looking to help solve a problem because the co-ops don't have 5 spare megawatts. Talk to the Wilson boys. They added 2.5 into the same co-op, and it took a lot more cooperation with the G&T co-op above. So Back to answer your question, bringing an opportunity instead of a problem.
Uh-huh.
The second was bringing a personal one-to-one approach. I was just the heartland, man. And if you don't love being out here and having conversations with these people and, you know, taking 15 minutes to say goodbye because you've got something else to say, then you probably should be doing business somewhere else. But holy smokes, these people are just the heart of the earth and I love it out here. And so there was a long, slow education process and they gave me a tentative approval, but asked that I come up and speak with the board of directors and answer their questions as well. Most of our conversations with the individual RECs out here also included two representatives from their generation and transmission co-op.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a note too. Having a really good understanding of the organizational structure out here will help you a lot to identify opportunities and avoid problems.
So you're not just talking to the CEOs, but the engineers as well.
Yeah, well, they're the one that any smart CEO is going to go, can we do that?
Mm-hmm.
If I say yes, they hang the wires, right? The surprising part, and one of my big lessons learned in this thing, is don't overlook the county and land regulations. I ran into two hickeys that I didn't know was coming. One of them is, when we went to survey this 1 acre, the surveyor said, well, I'll survey it for you, but you can't sell less than an acre in Franklin County without a Board of Supervisors approval. And yep, for sure, they have a county board of supervisors, a group of farmers, landowners, forms a supervisory council, and they call the shots on stuff. And so we had to go explain what we were doing, and then we're not going to turn it into a hog farm. They had specifically put that regulation in place to limit the number of drive-by hog confinements.
They do stink up the place.
Yeah. Well, once the supervisors said, you know, understood, and we had the REC's approval and backing and with this, they said, yeah, no problem. You can buy an acre, but you need to get it zoned from ag to commercial. And so then you got to wait another month. And so all these meetings are a month apart and they require notice in the paper before, right? So it's like, yeah. You just got to slow down, you know, out here. So then we got that done and then we got it closed on and all that kind of stuff. And I had friends and Iowa natives helping me through, my Iowa land guy. Didn't know about this at all. He's from a different county.
So much nuance to all this.
Dude, in the world we live in, somebody's going to be regulating everything.
Yeah. Some people have legitimate concerns. Some people are just justifying their existence.
One of the things that I've learned in this process, because I've been cock-blocked and denied on countless occasions, mm-hmm. None of them were completely unreasonable. The regulations were not unreasonable once I understood the context and was not taken by surprise. The way in which they were implemented frustrated me mightily because nobody said anything until. Then you go, well, that's a surprise. Now I'm mad. What do I do about that, right? You got to deal with all that shit.
So, Jeff, you've had a lot of hurdles in getting this mine built, but you have built it. So hurdle and success, what failures have you had and how did you get over those failures and move past them?
I'm a little bit of a student of business because I own two of them. And one of the things that's become clear here is that Bitcoin mining as a business has some advantages because it requires no employees
mm-hmm.
and requires no customers. The disadvantage is that you sell a commodity, so you have to take a price. And if you don't have any customers and you don't have any employees, the only thing I had left to leverage was money and time.
Mm-hmm.
There's really only four levers in business: customers, employees, time, and money. When you don't have the customers, employees, by choice, it's a business design decision. You got time and money. And so everything that I learned cost me a lot of time and a lot of money.
Okay. Those two factors are magnified.
That's all you got. I mean, what else are you going to do to move the business mm-hmm. forward, right? Mm-hmm. Think about it.
You've gone from being a home miner to scaling up quickly, hosting. You had some issues, not with the people that you hosted with personally, but some back end stuff and, you know, humans. That's what you eventually deal with. You decide to do this yourself. You have a lot of successes. You've gotten it done. It is challenging, but what advice that you've learned from your mining journey, not just being a successful businessman, but being a pleb miner, what advice can you offer to other pleb miners who want to scale up beyond a small home mining operation or a small, you know, couple petahash operation?
You know, God bless my partner, Jeff Phillip. He's been immensely valuable because of his insights, and he's kind of my consigliere. He helps me think through shit. So one of the leverage points that you get off of employees and customers is validation of your ideas and questioning of your assumptions. And when you have no employees and no customers, nobody there to question your assumptions. So literally every mistake I made was an assumption on my part, didn't turn out to be true, right? It's that Mark Twain saying about, it's not the things that you don't know that'll get you, it's the things that you know for damn sure that just ain't so. And that's what's got me every step of the way. So my advice is, your ideas ain't a secret. Put it out there in, on the internet, on paper, or something like that. Like, the more you can think through it on paper before you write a check for something, the better, or spend a Bitcoin for something, because I spent Bitcoin to build this mine. And so the more you can think about it, the better off you're going to be in the long run. Ask those questions. Just ask lots of questions, get lots of friends to disabuse you of notions, because every mistake I made cost money and was usually an assumption on my part.
So that's the power of the Pleb Miner community, Bitcoin Twitter, all these different Telegram groups that we're in, from the home mining wizards to our own private Telegram groups and chatting back and forth. You have to appreciate the Pleb Miner community, because if you have a stupid idea, they will tell you about it. I think that's a good place to end our conversation. Jeff, thank you so much for joining us on Pleb Miner in the Wild. We have so much to learn from you and your experiences. I think a longer interview is sorely needed. You've got a lot to share and so many more stories, I'm sure. I hope that you'll join either Max or I in a future recording so we can get to know you better, and give Dot a couple scratches behind the ear for us.
Jeff and Dot just had enough of you there. No goodbye.
Yeah, nothing. Cut me off.
They just walked off. They just went, oh, fuck this guy.
Yeah, so peace, I'm out of here.
Fair enough. I can't believe someone changed the credentials and had his miners running. I'd have been fucking livid.
Yeah.
Oh, that is proper cum piss behavior.
He was kind of breezy about it. Like, somebody changed the credentials.
That's what I thought. What do you say, 8 months?
Once you've had that kind of experience in life, you know, running business, running successful businesses and selling them and spinning up another successful business, and just get to the point where, well, I'm not going to get upset about every little thing that happens to me. I'm just going to move on.
It's life, but it's still fucking annoying. I'd want to know. I'd be like, who's fucking gone in there? And like, why couldn't you get them back is the other thing I was thinking. If they're in there for 8 months and someone sells it from underneath the person who was leasing it from.
He did get his machines back.
But not for 8 months.
We'll have to clarify that with him, because it was my understanding it was like, as he was building, they were kind of like in limbo.
Okay. Well, I'll write to him, because he obviously had enough of you.
He did. He was on his way to visit the Wilson boys, who are also in Iowa. And those are two brothers that started another farm, I guess not too far away from him. And he went to visit them. And he even said after the visit, like, no Telegram group or Twitter or chatting with the boys can replace the lessons that he learned just by going to see the Wilson guys and experiencing their challenges and triumphs.
Sounded like he's got a real good setup there, and hopefully we'll get him on the show and have a full episode with him.
Yeah, there's a lot of knowledge in that guy's brain that we need to get out. He's got an interesting life story too that I really would like to hear. As he's talking in there though, throughout the interview, I thought, this is what Baseload's talking about, these kind of challenges that you run into in dealing with the power company. And Jeff is dealing with a local co-op, and that's kind of neat that he actually sent emails out to the CEOs of these companies, and four of them came back and actually spoke to him. That's kind of neat. You don't think about that kind of stuff. It's like, call the salesman, maybe talk to a local engineer, but to actually talk to the person pulling the strings.
Yeah, that's smart.
It's a strategy I wouldn't think of, because I don't think from that level. So I appreciated Jeff's perspective. I don't think from the smart level. There are a couple things that Jeff said in there, and this is something Chet says also. The longer you can last, the more you win. Playing the long game in mining. I think a lot of people have started mining and dropped off for whatever reason. Like, oh shit, I'm going to cash out in this bull market. And then they never find their entry point back in, kind of like Nico Smid was talking about.
Too much leverage.
Yeah, he's playing the long game. This is a long game, and that's that. There's another thing that he said. What was that Mark Twain quote? It was like,
it's the things you don't expect that knock you off your feet, or something to that effect.
It ain't the things you don't know that gets you into trouble. It's what you know for sure that ain't so.
Yeah, that was it.
I love that one. Jeff was an interesting guy to talk to. What are some other things he said? Oh, your ideas aren't a secret. I like that one too. He's very open. You know, I think anybody that wants to start a farm, reach out to Jeff. I guarantee you he will give you, if you're sincere, I guarantee you Jeff will give you advice on how to start and be open and honest and share things with you.
Yeah, very good interview.
Well, before we close out the show, Max, do you have anything you want to talk about?
Yes. Birthing pools.
Birthing pools?
Yeah. Pools where you would give birth. And our little Dutch friend who's been building something very, very cool.
Yeah, Bert was trying to build a birthing pool for his wife and his kid, obviously. and trying to heat the pool with an ASIC. I think he had run into some hurdles, as I've said a lot in this episode for some reason. A lot of challenges. And he wasn't able to get the project done in time for the baby because the baby sure as shit isn't going to wait for you to finish tinkering with your immersion project. But it was neat because he reached out to the immersion Telegram group and the Pleb Miner Telegram group because we've got a lot of immersion guys in there and just looking for advice on how to fix this. I think it was something with the hoses weren't quite working out. He was talking with Schnitzel on how to fix it. But you got to give him props because, man, Bertle... find any way to reuse waste heat that he can.
There's something really special as well about giving birth to your child in a pool that is heated by Bitcoin miners. That is something really special. When you're as nerdy and you care as much about Bitcoin as some of us do, that is a special thing.
Mm-hmm. It's like I thought it was cool a couple years ago when I heated my house with it. I mean, this guy's kid is being born into it.
Bringing new life into the world with Bitcoin.
Bringing new life while bringing in new blocks.
I'd like to see somebody build it. I think it's pretty cool. There's quite a lot of births. People are popping them out left, right, and center. So
they just keep being born.
Yeah. This is something that needs to be built.
Get it done. Somebody get this done. Or somebody help Bert finish it. Hurry up. Get this edited. Crown, get this animated. Get this out. Call to action.
I assume it has to be immersion. Can you imagine how much his missus would be annoyed by it? In the air. Normally, when someone's doing like a home birth and they've got the pool, they've got like that kind of like music, like calm and whoosh, or like the waves or whatever. That's all got a screaming miner. The baby's like, fuck this, I'm staying in.
Who can scream louder, mom or the miner?
Yeah, immersion, I think, is best there.
Speaking of pleb miners in the wild and heat capture, I have in my grubby, dirty, greasy little hands some boards here from Zach Bomsta.
Ooh, have you tried them?
Buddy, not yet. I just got them last night. I will have a tinker this weekend. Pretty cool.
Very cool.
Yeah, my trick the machine into using a 110 board. I forget, but that's good. That might be called the Loki board. You see on the back. He's got all these little things all over the board. You know, I have been repairing electronics since the mid-90s. I have been trained by the United States Navy. Marine Corps doesn't have anything. We go everywhere with the Navy to repair at a circuit level to NASA specifications. You know, I've been in this industry for a long time and deployed a lot of field equipment.
Ooh, you're odd.
I'm credentialed. I'm regarded in this space.
Well, let me tell you something. I've been breaking electronics for the last 30 years. All right?
That's why we're buddies.
At the same level. Doesn't matter how well engineered electronics are, I can break them.
I don't know, man. I'm going to send you these boards. You're going to be surprised. They're thick. THICC, thick. They got all kinds of different little doodads on them, and they seem to be well done. And they have a little picture like of a little Loki man on them.
Ooh.
Yeah.
If he wants to send me some boards, I'll do some free testing. I'll break them, and then you can fix them.
Or are you going to break into the Compass facility and put these on there? And say, hey, guys, I just come in with these boards in my pocket. I'm just going to play around with some of these.
They'll charge me $500 just to fucking enter.
Well, Zach Bomsta has delivered as promised. I have these boards in my hand, and I am really looking forward to messing around with them and posting it all on Twitter, because isn't that what we do? Tell everybody every part of our freaking lives.
Can we have some pictures and documentation of what you've done with them?
Yes, I will do all that.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
I'll just press retweet.
You're good for that.
Right. What else we got? Is that all?
That's it.
Right. Well, it's been a pleasure, mate.
So says you.
Well, I'll catch you on the next one. I look forward to seeing what you're doing with these boards, and I will be retweeting.
No doubt. Bye.
Adios.